Shall we have another program of some sort?
Swamikul, I would like to know the fundamental difference between religion and ism.
Isms, yes.
And the definition of religion.
Well, there is no hard and fast line which can be drawn between the two, because some religions are in fact isms and some isms are religions. For instance, Confucianism and Taoism, they are both religions. But there are many known religions which are in fact cults, like the Moonites and let's join hands and die and these things. They are all in fact. The fundamental difference between the two is, as we understand from Islamic point of view, otherwise as far as the definition of the world at large is concerned, there is no such definition. Islamic definition would be any way of life which has originated from the Creator Allah. Now, the originated is the important part of it, because later on the religions deviate by the passage of time, they get corrupted and deviate from the right path. So they are not recognizable, though they have originated originally from Allah, but they no longer belong to Him. Still they would be called religions. So that is the definition according to Islam.
Another part of the same question. Does this definition apply Sikhism and Baha'ism?
Sikhism and Baha'ism, as far as we are concerned, Ahmadiyya point of view is concerned, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has laid it down very clearly that after the final revelation of Islam as a religion, there cannot be a new religion in the world. Otherwise, the finality of Islam would become meaningless. So, Baha'ism, according to us, is a man-made process which may have resulted originally from a deviation from Islam, but later on it has come into its own and has become as an independent religion, acquired the nature, character of an independent religion. As far as Sikhism is concerned, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has categorically declared and proved it, that Sikhism is no new religion. It is in fact Islam and nothing else. Hazrat Guru Baba Nanak was a convert to Islam from Hindus. His parents were Hindus and he got fed up of idolatry. So at his young age, in fact right from his childhood, he was averse to any form of idol worship. So gradually he got attracted towards Islam, and he accepted Islam gradually. First, we know that he got initiated at the hands of a Sufi in Shekhupura district, Nankana Sahib. So there he remained in his company for a while and started speaking of Wahdat, that is the unity of God, and singing hymns to Allah like a Muslim Sufi. So gradually his fame spread among Hindus as well as Muslims as a godly person. So he gained quite a few followings from both Muslims and Hindus equally. So this is why, to begin with, Sikhs drew their adherents both from the Muslims and Hindus. But later on, he preached more among the Hindus, and the majority of his followers came from Hinduism. Then he performed Hajj, and that is where he took Bhai Mardana with him. Bhai Mardana was also a Muslim convert, in fact, Muslim follower of his. So to begin with, it was not a new religion at all. It was a type of Sufism, and through this Sufism he succeeded in gaining quite a few converts from the Hindus. But later on, after his death, the first seed of a dissension or a new formation is observable. At the time of, before the time of his disposal of his body, a debate erupted between those who had followed him from among the Muslims and those who had followed him from among the Hindus. And the Hindus wanted to burn his body because this was their culture. And the Muslims wanted to bury the body. So a very difficult situation arose. In fact, there was a possibility of bloodshed between the two groups. So the Muslims were wiser in the sense that they advised them that we should better wait for the morning and let's wait for the will of Allah to appear. Because our saint was a godly person, so during the night Allah may show something which will decide the issue. So what Allah did was that Allah gave opportunity to the Muslims to run away with the body during the night. So they ran away with the body and buried it somewhere. And in the morning they told, or the Hindu converts surmised, that perhaps God, the body was taken up, ascended to the heavens. And they were very happy with this sign. And they were thankful to the Muslim converts for the timely advice. Otherwise they might have burnt before Allah could take it up. So this is how Sikhism came into being, a sort of. But even at that time, their behavior was Muslim. They remembered the verses of the Holy Quran, and most of the teachings of Hazrat Guru Baba Nanak are based on the teachings of the Holy Quran. They are in fact translations of the Holy Quran or commentary upon the Holy Quran or the saying of Hazur Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the sort of Punjabi that was spoken in those days. It is called Gurmukhi. But basically it is a form of Punjabi. So after a while, some other gurus followed. The real separation from the Muslims took place much later. In fact, these Sikhs gradually became criminals. And because of their criminal activities, the Muslim kingdom, that was the Mughal Empire, they tried to suppress their activities, and some people believe that they were unnecessarily harsh upon them. It was a wrong political decision to come to clash with the Sikhs. But anyway, I am not at the moment concerned with the history, what actually happened. But this we know, that gradually they were driven to the jungles. And the five Ks of the Sikhs resulted from that wildlife which they followed, which they pursued from then on. The five Kadas were naturally, five Ks as they're called, Karpan, Kada, and this gaze nahi ke with the throat, Ganga. No, no, what they throw for to kill that kirpan, no, no, that round weapon, that is called kada. Kada is hair, not hair. That is case is the hair, but I am talking of that round sharp weapon which they put on the turban. That is also one of the cases, isn't it? Oh, I see. I'm sorry. I thought that would be. Otherwise, five are completed. Kada, kes, kirpan, kanga, kacha. These were the basic requirements of a Sikh. In the jungle life, they didn't want much elaborate dress. As long as they had a sort of jangia, that was quite enough. And kirpan was to fight. And kada also was, I think, was a symbol of Sikhism, is bond, their bondage to Hazrat Guru Baba Nanak. Also it was used as a weapon by hitting, yes. And kanga, because of they were afraid of lice, because of the case, kanga was a natural, you know, resultant of that. And these Sikhs, because of this kanga, they keep their case very clean. I mean, most of the Sikhs who are educated and live abroad, they are very they have very hygienic habits. But only in the villages, like in other communities, the case is of a disadvantage. So this is why some wise guru advised them to have a kanga with them all the time. Yes, please.
Hazur, I just want to make an observation only with regard to Sikh religion and the truth of the Holy Quran. In January 76, I went to Kadia with my wife and requested Hazrat Miah Waseem Ahmad Sahib whether he could arrange for us to see the Chola Sahib, which he very kindly did. So we went to Dera Baba Nanak by road, via Khara, and there's another place where
it's about 40 miles from Qadian, I suppose.
76
miles, I see.
January 76.
It's near the bridge Bias. Uh-huh. Is it near the bridge Bias?
Yes,
Bias
sir.
Bridge.
Yes, sir. There about near the bridge.
That would be about that. Yes.
Yeah. And when we went there, the Granthi, the Chola Sahib is now put in a little casket, not under a lot of clothes. And it's a sort of, which can
it's,
open.
It's always on the exhibition, is it?
Sir?
Is it on the exhibition?
No, sir. Because Hazrat Miah Sahib arranged one of the trustees to go with us. He's an advocate from Batala.
I see.
And there, Malik Salahuddin Sahib also showed me the place where Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam used to sit outside the court pending hearing of the cases. Anyway, when we reached Dera Baba Nanak, the man on duty, he opened the casket and he first took out Chola Sahib.
Took it out?
Yes, sir. Because one of the trustees was with us.
Is the cloth strong enough?
It's getting decayed. So actually, I told Mr. Bedi, the advocate, who one of the owners, I should say, why don't they send it to England and get it treated? And he said, Dar Sahib, I padhuye ke andar hai, jaisa kalyate prashat ho jayega.
Nahi, why don't they call somebody, some expert there, and under his advice, they can treat the chola.
They say it will become parshat if other people touch it.
No, I don't advise that. I mean some experts should be called from here. Yes. Under their instruction, local Sikhs could treat the chola.
Yes, that's a good
idea.
That
should be, I think that advice should be sent to Qadian.
Yes.
If they want any help in this regard, we'll get the information and try to help them. Because even if we have to bear the expenses, I'm ready. Because that's a sign of the truth of Islam, and also that of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam with the same process, because it was revealed to him that Chola bears the Holy Quran and inscriptions. So it's very important to us that it's preserved. So you kindly write to Mir Sinha Sahib on my behalf.
The cloth has now become sort of brownish, but the writing of the Holy Quran is in a beautiful handwriting and deep dark black ink.
Beautiful.
And then there is a...
You could read it. You could read it?
Yes, sir. Good. Easily, sir, very clearly. And then there was a piece of cloth, chuzi.
Did you take a picture of that as well?
I did, sir. We were standing around the chola. I'll bring it, sir.
You have got the picture?
Yes, sir.
Even in that picture you could read the Holy
Quran?
No,
sir. Not clearly, sir. No, sir.
I see.
And there is a piece of cloth. And we were told that it was given by Hazrat Baba Nanak to his daughter in Jahej.
I see.
Yes. And the beauty of that cloth...
That is chunni. That is chunni.
Chunni, sir. Yes. I'm sorry, I'm deaf on my one side.
And which side is that? Which side is deaf?
Right, sir.
I see.
And the beauty of that chunni is that it has been embroidered. But both sides are Siddha Parsa, we call it. There is no sort of Kutta Parsa.
Right.
It's beautiful, really. Then Granthi Sahib, Mr. Bedi, took us to another Gurdwara nearby. He said, Dar Sahib, I'll show you something. He took out a Granth, must be very old, handwritten. And each page has a borderline, border of flowers. And the beauty is that the floral design of one page does not agree with the other. It's all different, or 360 pages. But yet another thing which he showed us, he says, Dar Sahib, our Granth has also been changed. I said, our Quran has not been changed. There was a young Granthi sitting there who objected to his remarks. So he brought that Granth, the old one, opened pages and showed a certain verse there. Then he got the latest Granth, opened the same page, that verse was missing from the new Granth.
See,
that's
right.
Another proof of Quran's truth.
Did you note down the missing verses?
No, sir, I didn't, sir.
That also should be written to Bedi, to me, or Sina Ahmed, to find out from Bedi which verses are missing. And if he again is kind enough to take some scholar to write down, the verses, maybe they are the ones which are favorable to Islam.
That's right.
Yes.
Malik Salahuddin Sahib was with us, he might remember.
Yes. Thank you. Yes, please, Gauri Sahib.
Hazur, Islam allows intermarriages, that is to say, within the families. But the medical doesn't approve very much, you being the physician as well, homeopathic. What is your opinion?
Well, we have seen good results from these intermarriages. We know in some families there has been a long history of intermarriages without any ill effect. But because the families also get new blood, that intermarriage is dangerous, medically speaking. Also, it has some advantages, but I'll come to that later. That intermarriage system can be dangerous, where the families do not marry outside at all, and no new blood is introduced. So just the permission for intermarriage does not entail any dangers whatsoever. Close marriages, that is the term in fact which should be used in this regard. Those families who close the doors to outside marriages and remain within a very close circuit. Sometimes it is not a family, it is a religion, for instance. The Jews, they marry among the Jews. The Israelites, that is to say a particular race, continues to marry among that particular people. Now, what happens is that according to the laws of genetics, the defects also get multiplied. And occasionally a monster is born. Similarly, the good points of and good characters also go on accumulating and get multiplied, with the result that some genius is born sometimes, almost bordering on monstrosity. So this is what happens, and this is why in the Jews there are monsters of each type, every type. There are some freaks, some people who have done great damage to humanity, and there are many great scholars and great scientists and philosophers born among the Jews who have helped the mankind a lot. So, although now they have become a very large community for these defects or good qualities to go on multiplying, but still the same principle applies more intensely to the closer circles of families or clans. But to avoid, on both sides there are points, there are pros as well as cons. So for this reason, to attack Islam, that Islam has done wrong to permit intermarriage, is absolutely not logical at all. First of all, that intermarriage which is permitted by Islam is not a closed circuit intermarriage. It is a permission to intermarry with all doors open to marry among others. In fact, by doing away with the caste system, Islam invites new blood from all directions. And by doing away with the nationalities prejudices, it further enriches the Muslim blood from all people of the world. So this is why you will find that Muslims have married much more freely among the people where they ruled, with the result that within a matter of a few generations, they got completely mixed up with the local people. While the Europeans who object to this system, they are not found to intermarry among the people they conquered, and they kept their race intact. So, in fact, Islam's teachings is much broader in attitude than any other teaching. You want to ask a question? Or just to fill the gap? I'm asking you. Yes, please come. You want to fill the gap? Okay. Let's see how best you fill it.
That's why I was thinking. Although this is the first question in my life, and that's why I'm shaking. And
but you don't look like shaking at all.
No, I'm shaking, sir.
You see, inside.
Although I'm shaking, I will try my best.
Good, very good.
This question is from my friend who doesn't believe in God.
Where are you from?
Me from London.
You're in London?
Yes.
Where about?
From Wandsworth.
From Wandsworth, I see.
Yes.
And your parents?
In Pakistan.
You're in Pakistan?
Yes.
I see. When did you come here?
About 5 years.
5 years, okay. Yes. You're settled here now?
Yes.
Okay. Now, are you the one who wrote to me about this friend, or was it somebody else? Only the other day I received a letter from an MD young boy. No, you are not. Okay, now you start your question.
Yes. He said, your God has announced in your Holy Quran, according to the Holy Quran, that He has every power. And he said, if I want to do something, I just say, kun, then fayakun. Why did he say, خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ, and he created the heaven and the earth in 7 days? for this meaning. I just want to
satisfy him. Has he originated from among the Christians?
Yes.
He has completely misunderstood the import of this verse because he is translating it in the light of the biblical teaching. According to the Bible, Allah said, be, and it was. According to the Holy Quran, it is not it was. According to the Holy Quran, kun fayakun. Allah said, be, and it began to be, and it would be ultimately completed. So the Holy Quran paints a picture of a gradual process of creation, and also tells us of the such attributes of Allah which require Him to create through processes, step after the step, until the ultimate is reached. In tears, you find the process of creation in tears, not immediately. So from the Quranic teachings, nothing is objectionable. Moreover, eternity demands that the process should be slow and continuous. Because if everything which Allah wants is done immediately, then there will be no future. Everything would be just past. It's a contradiction in itself. If Allah is eternal, there has to be a past as well as a future. So His will is not like human beings, which suddenly comes to Him. If He has the knowledge of everything, His knowledge covers both the past and the future. So if everything which He knows and He wants to be done is done immediately, then everything, every creation will be a matter of the past. There will be nothing left for the future. So it's not a hasty, impatient God like it is presented by a corrupted Bible. Originally, we don't think Bible could ever have uttered such a thing. Maybe there is something wrong with the translation. But the wordings of the Holy Quran are beyond any censure whatsoever. You put a very good question. Why don't you try another one? There were no signs of any nervousness. Pan?
It's a sign.
Yes, please.
Sadhguru.
Who are you?
I'm Shahid Ahmed.
Son of
Mrs. Bhatti, Sadhguru Ezra. My question is, what are Islam's views on violent self-expression and violent self-defense in the form of the written word?
Self-defense and what?
Self-defense and self-expression in the form of the written word. In other words, poetry, music, stories, etc.
I couldn't follow this question. Could you?
Yeah, ma'am. Could you just stay a little away from the divine?
Oh, why not come closer to me instead of staying away? Come here. What is it you want to know? Please come here closer to me. Huh? Because I don't really understand the question.
What I mean is, what does Islam object to or accept, especially the Ahmadis, in expressing themselves violently in terms of self-defense?
Now I understand quite right. Yes, yes. No. He wants to understand why Ahmadis don't use their right of self-defense. Is it because some Quranic injunction? And where is it said in the Holy Quran that you should not act in self-defense? Is that what you understand?
But in a non-Bible, in a non-physical form. In other words, the written word meant as
non-violence.
but most of us, why is it that we cannot express ourselves in, for example, in painting, in music, in other things?
No, this is not self-defense. Is that what you want to know?
Self-expression.
Self-expression is the thing, yes. Islam doesn't, is not against self-expression at all. Who told you it, Islam is? Okay.
In terms of violence, expression.
Violent expression. Again, this violence I just don't understand.
Because
see? You are completely off the mark. When I said, as I understood your question and I explained it, was I right?
Yes.
That is what you wanted to know? So don't interfere, please. Please sit down. Yes. He wants to know why Ahmadis do not exercise their right of self-defense if they have a right of self-defense. If not, where is it written in the Holy Quran that you are not permitted to defend yourselves rightfully? Right? Am I right? Good. The fact is that Islam does not prevent you from exercising your right of self-defense at all, anywhere. Yet Islam requires you to exercise patience for a good cause, particularly in religious persecutions. The threshold for retaliation is set very high by Islam, not because Islam wants to deprive people of their right, but because Islam wants to gain the objective of their lives and prefers this to the physical sacrifice. For instance, in the early days of Islam, up to the year 13th, when Hijrah took place, the Muslims were very severely persecuted, yet they were not permitted to defend themselves, and that was the wisest course for them to take. Because it was that persecution, in fact, which hollowed the whole opposition against them. And within all the people who had some humanity left in them, they began to sympathize with the Islamic cause. And they began to believe that they are true and they are honest. Otherwise, they could not have offered such sacrifice with such perseverance. This is why after the Fateh Makkah, despite the fact that no sword was applied at all to change their religion, and they were given quarters by Islam at the moment of that great victory, not only one quarter, but in every form, so many quarters were offered to them. There was no threat whatsoever to anybody's personal life except for the four people who had exceeded in transgression so much that they were not forgiven. Later on, some of them were also forgiven. But the point I'm making is, no sword was applied to change the religion of the Meccans, yet they accepted Islam. Why? Because they had started moving in the direction of Islam from the very first persecution. And the patience pays you much more than retaliation. So when a general is planning to gain a territory, the ultimate goal is to win. The final victory is the most important thing. So in that process, sometimes he has to exercise patience, sometimes they have to retreat for a while, despite the fact that every time they have a right to kill. So to kill is not the purpose of life, particularly in Islam. Or to defend bodily is not the purpose either. The purpose is to spread Islam. And in whichever way Islam's cause is served in this direction, that way would be adopted by the Muslims. This is the teaching we receive from the Holy Quran as well as from the practice of Ahadrat sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet the Islam very clearly says that if transgression is exercised against you and you cannot tolerate, you have every right to defend. It is not forbidden to Ahmadis either. If the Ahmadis are wronged in any matter, they have right from the Quranic point of view as well as from the country's laws point of view to defend themselves. But they don't, because they know if they began to defend, there are many reasons why they don't. Number one, so far I have not permitted them to let themselves go. And it is their own judgment as well. They understand the philosophy behind it. They know if they take their revenge personally and individually, the Ahmadis all over Pakistan would suffer much more, because they are weak. If in some places they are strong enough, in many other places, out of all proportion to some places, they are much weaker. So once you begin to take your revenge imprudently, you suffer the more for it. That is something which everybody knows. Yet every Ahmadi is hurt so deeply that now they have reached a stage that they want to suffer. It is not because of that prudence that now they are acting like this. Originally they understood the thing, but now they are fed up with all this nonsense. And they want my permission to let them go, but I won't. I know that. Why? Because the second reason is much more important to me. And that is, this persecution is winning us many more hearts than spoken preaching by the word of mouth could ever have achieved for us. Vast number of non-Ahmadis are being more and more convinced that they are right and they are honest and they are true. And despite the fact that such severe measures are taken against Ahmadis, legally as well as otherwise, the process of the spread of Ahmadiyyat has not come to a stop at all. In some places, it has hastened. And comparatively, comparatively, in some cities and towns, we are gaining more rapidly than ever before. So there are two factors which are very important to us. The general sentiment of the masses is changing in our direction. Number two, they are getting fed up of their mullah. And most often than not, they begin to hate them, and they know they are hollow people, they are inhuman, they are attributing atrocities towards Islam and to the holiest of the Prophet. So their inner conscience is rising against their own mullahs. So this is such a big advantage that even if thousands of Ahmadis are slaughtered, this advantage is worth it. And they would not care as long as they gain in the direction of ultimate victory. I mean, they move in the direction of the ultimate victory. And this is exactly what they are doing. So Islam wants us to behave prudently. Islam tells us, if anybody is wronged, he has every right to take his revenge. But man afa wa aslaha fa ajruhu ala Allah. If anybody decides to forgive, he is permitted to forgive. It is not that you must take your revenge. Revenge you can take, but you're also permitted to forgive under one condition, which is also laid down in this verse. faman afa wa aslaha, if you forgive on the condition that your forgiveness causes reformation, fa ajruhu ala Allah, everyone who does so, his reward will be with Allah. So if this is our purpose, that we forgive not out of weakness or cowardice, but we forgive with an aim in mind, with a very noble objective in view, then Allah says, as long as your decision is correct, that your forgiveness is causing reformation, then not only it is permitted, you will have additional reward from Allah. So this is again, how can we work against our own interests? Now you understand? So glad. Any other question, please? Only there are 5 minutes left to wait. Yes, please. Rafiq Sahib has come to... Now you know how precious Chaudhary Muhammad Abdul Rashid is to us.
Assalamu alaikum.
Yes.
This thing is agitating my mind for a long time, you see. It is during 1964, when I was in Nigeria. I'm still in Nigeria anyhow. So there was one gentleman who was non-Ahmadi, and I was also non-Ahmadi.
I know that, yes, yes, at that time.
So we were working in one office, and then there was another gentleman who was a Christian, and some Tablighi Jamaat came, and I had a great respect for them at that time. So we started talking about it. That gentleman was...
Tablighi Jamaat people were from Pakistan or...?
Oh yes, sir.
They had come from Pakistan.
A group of about eight, 9 people.
Correct.
Well, they were doing so many nice things themselves. I respect in that respect. Because they never tried to take any food from any place. They were living in the mosque. They were doing... But their impact was temporary. Once they leave, the thing goes away. So at that time, they talk in old language and the people were all coming around them. But once they leave, the thing is forgot. Anyhow, the gentleman had married with a German wife. So he was very much outspoken, talking so much against Islam or sometime. He was a little bit liberal, you can see it. So the Christian was there. He said, look, these people are coming and just professing Islam in one way or the other, while they are not correcting themselves. Now, then he spoke to me, the Muslim one, non-Ahmadi one.
Just a minute.
So he
I
said
have got a bit confused.
Yes, sir.
Please kindly...
There were two gentlemen. One was non-Ahmadi and the other was Christian.
I thought there were so many.
No, sir.
You said a few...
No, because that Tablighi Jamaat people came into discussion only that time.
I see.
So because I was associated with
now,
that...
There were three people.
And then we were just sitting three people in the same office. We were employed in the same office.
And one was a Christian and one was a
Muslim. That Muslim.
And who had married a German?
That Muslim one.
That Muslim one had.
That's right.
And he was speaking against...
He was speaking, he said that... Look,
was he speaking against Christianity?
Yes, against the Tablighi Jamaat.
Against the Tablighi Jamaat.
Yes, he said that, look, these gentlemen are wasting their money. They are not correcting themselves. They are just coming here and unnecessarily, you see, they should correct themselves first. He quoted a verse. He said that, look, وَلَمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّةَ. Anybody who fears from God, he has two types of jannah. Is that so? So, these Christians and these advanced country people, are much better performing their huquq-ul ibad. They are good people by that one. But they just come and they say that perform huquq Allah. What does it mean? First you correct yourself, and all Muslims at this time throughout the world at large, not specifically few people, then you see they are maybe alright, huquq Allah and huquq ibad. But most of them are only talking of huquq Allah. They don't do it huquq ibad. If you will go to other countries who are Christian, who are non-Muslims, they perform better huquq Allah. I had also an instance, I got a check from somebody here. Once I got the money, then I just wrote my address that I am living here. It is about 7 years back, here in this London. So the lady gave me £1 less. That £1 was sent back to my house and to say that, look, I'm very sorry that we have given you wrong money. Then I counted that £1 was less. So this is the best thing of this, and this will give you better prophecy. So this is what I say, that now whether huquq al ibad are important.
Since 1964,
yes, this is agitating my mind. And I personally say, sir, that I got this bet in 1978, as you know, but still I did not change in huquq al ibad amongst ourselves.
Just a minute.
That's right.
Sit down.
Yes.
Your question has to be straightened up first. Huh?
That's right.
And put in the right order before we can proceed to tackle it. The question as it appears to me is this. Number one, that huquq Allah are all right. You're not against huquq Allah, are you? You don't mean to say...
No, I say that huquq Allah is acceptable.
Okay. But we should first start with huquq al-ibad. Is that right?
Yes.
Isn't it? So this is exactly what Islam tells you.
But this thing is not that...
Just a minute. If it is not practiced, whose fault it is? Islam's or the people's? So? Blame people and not Islam. The Islam that I know teaches you huquq al-ibad to a degree that you cannot become God-fearing, truly God-fearing, unless you have started to pay the human beings their dues. Ahadith sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has expressed this in so many ways and repeatedly. Ahadith sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us at one place, Man lam yashkurin nasa, lam yashkurillaha. Whoever is ungrateful to the people is also ungrateful to Allah. At another place he tells us that who does not show pity to human beings, he will not be shown pity by Allah. So in either direction it is very important. But to say to first you should, this objection is wrong, because the manner of this objection is wrong, because when somebody speaks to you about the huququllah or the rights of Allah, this answer is wrong, that you should first start doing this, because they both interplay. In fact, Ahadra sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has equated them most beautifully. In fact, what he means to say is that they both interplay upon each other. A truly God-fearing person would pay his dues to the people. And a person who pays his dues to the people has come a step closer to his God, because he knows how to pay his dues and discharge his obligations. So this is why Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has spoken at length the process of upbringing of Ahadra sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, first of all, he turned the beastly people into human beings. then human beings into moral beings, then moral beings into godly beings. And you cannot be a truly godly being without not only a human being, but a moral being. So this process is correct, there is no doubt. But right from the start, Hakukulla are also being discharged simultaneously. There is no waiting. When we talk of that first, that takes place in a different manner. You don't start first with the Hakukul Ibad and wait for a few years and then start talking of Hakukulla. This first is a manner of not preference, but a manner of order. That is to say that simultaneously both processes are taking shape in every human being. And his upbringing and his cultivation. If a man begins to move towards God, even if he takes a single step, in that single step too, there would also be a step in of that nature in the direction of humanity for everything. Because what is traveling towards God? What is paying dues to the dues of God? The essence of this worship is that ultimately you acquire the attributes of Allah. And because the attributes of Allah are a source of beneficence to his people, his creation. So it is impossible for you to acquire an attribute of Allah without showing it to your human beings, to your fellow beings. So if you truly analyze the process, although we speak of first and second, but it is not in terms of months and years, it is in the terms of split-second decisions. If you really want to truly move towards Allah, you have to rectify yourself, your inner being, your attitude. And when that attitude is rectified, then at the same moment, you begin to behave correctly to your human friends or fellow beings, also to Allah. So that is taqwa. When people begin to talk against such people, in fact, they misunderstand the whole process. And what they do is, they just want to retaliate against a sort of piety which they know they are missing. So to show their superiority, they always begin to talk in this sense. Those people who came from Pakistan, even if they were wrong in their some views, they had some good points. At least they said their prayers in time. If they were arrogant about it, that was wrong. I mean, Allah would then not reward them. But the fact of prayer was good. For a man who was not saying prayer, to start criticizing them just because they were saying praying, that was wrong. The correct, honest attitude for such a person should have been that in paying their dues and respects to Allah, they are good. But if they are not at the same time paying their respects and dues to humanity, then whatever dues they are paying to Allah are hollow, because they cannot live without the other. A shadow is automatically cast. So that inference, if it had been drawn by that gentleman, that would have been correct. But mostly I know the attitude of such people. They feel at a disadvantage in one sphere. And to offset that disadvantage, they begin to pull the legs of those people and bring them down and put them below underneath. And say, our sphere is superior, so although apparently they are pious, but truly we are worthier people and more respectable than they are. So this attitude is wrong. Now I think ultimately we have reached the goal of prayer, eh? Without any gaps. Thank you for filling that gap. which helped us, you know, that in fact invited other questions as well. Thank you. Now somebody should say the Azan, please.